Welcome to EPG Padashala. I am Dr. P.P. Ajay Kumar, Professor of English, School of Distance Education, University of Kerala. Today we will discuss the famous play Lear by Edward Bond. And this come under the paper 20th Century English Literature. Edward Bond is considered to be an angry young man with revolutionary reformist zeal. He is a distinguished British dramatist, theatre director, poet, theorist, screenwriter, and on many ways he had associations with the drama. When the Second World War began in 1939, Bond, like many other people, were evacuated to the countryside. And during this time, he was exposed to violence of war, the bombing, and the continuous sense of danger and despair was part of Bond's early childhood days. So naturally, Bond generated a kind of antipathy to that kind of violence. But at the same time, the violence that he has witnessed created in him a kind of sense of horror that we find in his plays, extreme violence depicted on stage. His major works include The Pope's Wedding, published in 1962, Saved, published in 1964, Narrow Road to the Deep North, published in 1968, Early Morning, published in 1968, Lear in 1971, The Sea 1973, Bingo 1973, The Fool 1975, The Bundle 1978, Restoration in 1981. This is a very long list, and from this we understand how prolific Bond was. 1970s was a period of great creativity for Bond, and that period was known for the political unrest and activism leading up to the election of Margaret Thatcher's Conservative government in 1979. It was considered to be a decade of mass oppositional left-wing political activity. This particular period also witnessed the final years of Harold Wilson's Labour administration, which had first been elected to power in 1964. So it was an age of transition. His early 1980s plays were directly influenced by the coming to power of the Conservative Party. In Bond's plays, we find an undercurrent of left-wing politics. There is an indictment of the capitalist system and the ruling class, and he believes that the capitalists will corrupt the society, and so he has described himself as a revolutionary socialist. And his theatre is described as rational theatre. Its duty is to ask questions and find answers. The rational theatre gives meaning to history. It is also attempting to give an explanation for human miseries. Bond himself says that, "I call my plays rational, but they are often very passionate and very emotional plays, because passion and emotion are part of a rational life." Edward Bond was a critic of the theater of the absurd, because we find that according to him, it is culturally disastrous. And in absurd theater, you cannot find life, because life is not so absurd. According to him, the theater should address social issues. That is the only justification for going to theater. If the people come to theater, they should get at least an awareness about the problems that they face, and they should be actually, if the people go to theater, they should at least get an awareness about the problems that they face. And Edward Bond's theater attempts to do that. What makes Bond different from other playwrights is his concern for this cultural and theoretical issues connected with the contemporary society. According to him, literature should keep an eye on the posterity. And Bond is very passionate about that kind of literary activity. Edward Bond repeatedly stresses the need for awareness as well as action. His plays addresses the social issues and create awareness about these issues in the mind of the spectators. At the same time, it also demands action against social evils. This interdependence of the idea and action is one of the distinctive qualities of Edward Bond's plays. The subjects that he deals with are not minute, silly subjects. They are real problems that the society faces. I think now we could come to the play Lear. The title Lear obviously is a reference to the well-known play by Shakespeare, King Lear. Even though the name is a reference to Shakespeare's King Lear, Bond's play has very little to do with Shakespeare's play, King Lear. The background of the play is the Soviet invasion of Czechoslovakia in 1968, the assassination of Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy was another important incident of that time. During these years, the war in Vietnam was escalating, and British troops were sent to Northern Ireland. So we find that it was a period of war and violence. Students were deeply involved in politics, and there were mass demonstrations in campuses. So it became clear that the students could turn violent as well. In 1970, three members of the radical American group, the Weathermen, were killed when the bomb they were building for terrorist purposes exploded. So all these incidents might have influenced Lear while writing this play. The violence and cruelty was part of that particular age, and naturally it had its influence upon the playwright as well. Edward Bond's play Lear is considered to be the most violent drama ever staged. And naturally, there were several controversies connected with it. The play, as I said before, is a reworking of Shakespeare's King Lear. The playwright has adapted Shakespeare's King Lear mainly because he wanted to use the character King Lear and present a political experience connected with his contemporary life. He wanted the people to question the kind of violence that was happening in his contemporary society. So Bond's play Lear can be considered as an aesthetic response to the contemporary violence that was prevalent in his time. Now let us look at the play. When we look at the summary of the play in brief, we find that the central character is King Lear. He was building a wall in order to keep enemies out of his kingdom. And when one man, a worker, dies, Lear is very much affected by that because he thought that it will delay the construction of the wall. And he shoots the worker who accidentally caused the death of the man. He has two daughters, Bordis and Fontanelli. And they are having their own plans to marry Lear's enemies. They thought that through that marriage, they will be able to bring about peace. The Duke of North and the Duke of Cornwall are the two dukes who are supposed to marry these two daughters. But Lear's daughters, Bordis and Fontanelli, reveals their plans that they share with their husbands to attack Lear's armies. Each of these daughters wanted Warrington to betray Lear, then the other daughter as well. The sisters' armies have been victorious, but Bordis and Fontanelli each has failed at having her husband killed. So at that time, Warrington has become a prisoner and his tongue was cut. He is brought before the sisters. Bordis calmly knits while Warrington is tortured by her soldiers. The drama has several such violent scenes performed on stage. Lear is in the woods and he finds a bread on the ground and eats it. Warrington is now crippled. And when Lear sleeps, Warrington returns with a knife and attacks Lear and then leaves. A sergeant and three soldiers come onto the stage looking for Lear at that time. And Warrington's body is discovered plugging the well. And the soldiers kill the boy who assisted Lear and rape his wife Cordelia. And they also kill the pigs. The carpenter arrives and kills the soldiers. And Lear is taken as a prisoner. Then what we see is that the two daughters, Bordis and Fontanelli, bring Lear before a judge. When asked about Bordis and Fontanelli, Lear denies that they are his daughters. Bordis has her mirror given to Lear, as she believes that madmen are frightened of themselves. Lear sees himself in the mirror as a tortured animal in a cage. He is found to be mad and taken away. So now Bordis tells Fontanelli that there are malcontents in the kingdom and that there will be a civil war. Fontenelle replies that the rebels are led by Cordelia. Now we see that the ghost of the boy who died, who was killed, now appears to Lear in his cell. Lear asks the ghost to bring him his daughters. Then the apparitions that appear are of Bodice and Fontenelle as young girls. Lear and his daughters talk as the two girls sit with their heads on his knees. Lear asks the daughters to stay, but they leave him. The ghost reappears and asks Lear if he can stay with him. Lear agrees, saying that they will be comforted by the sound of each other's voices. Bodice and Fontenelle, talking at their headquarters, reveal the secret that their husbands have tried to desert them. Fontenelle is given Lear's death warrant by Bodice and signs it. Bodice reveals that she started to have the wall pulled down, but that she needed the workers as soldiers. Now Cordelia's soldiers, who appear leading Lear and other prisoners, have lost their way. Lear says that he only wants to live to find the ghost and help him. Fontenelle is brought in a prisoner also. In scene 6, Lear and the other prisoners, including Fontenelle, are in their cell. The ghost arrives. He is cold and thin. Lear says he wishes he had been the ghost's father and looked after him. Fontenelle tells Lear that if he helps her, she will protect him if Bodice is victorious. At the carpenter's command, the soldier shoots Fontenelle. A medical doctor, who is also a prisoner, arrives to perform an autopsy. Lear is awed by the beauty of the inside of the body of his daughter. It is perfectly in contrast to her cruelty and hatred that is outside. Bodice arrives as a prisoner, indicating that Cordelia's forces have defeated the last remnants of the daughter's regime. Lear tells his daughter that he destroyed Fontenelle. Bodice too has been sentenced to death. The soldiers stab her with a bayonet 3 times. Cordelia, now the carpenter's wife, has asked that Lear not be killed. Lear's eyes were removed using a scientific device, and Lear leaves the prison with the ghost. Then what we find is that Lear is living in the boy's old house, and he tells a group of people a fable, and the number of audience increase. There were hundreds of people who gathered to listen to Lear, and Lear complains that he is still a prisoner. There is a wall everywhere, and the ghost enters. He is thinner and more shrunken. The ghost suggests that he poisoned the well and will leave. He will take Lear along with him. Lear is alone in the wood. The ghost arrives. He is deteriorating rapidly and appears terrified. The ghost believes he is dying and weeps because he is afraid. Cordelia and Carpenter enters. Cordelia speaks of how the soldier killed her husband and raped her, and the way in which her new government is creating a better way of life. The ghost watches his former wife, wishing he could speak to her. Cordelia asks Lear to stop working against her. Lear tells Cordelia she must pull the wall down. but she says the kingdom will be attacked by enemies if she does. So we find that King Lear becomes aware of the fact that the war is a kind of danger to the society. Lear is taken to the war by Susan. Then he climbs up on the structure in order to dig it up. The farmer's son, now a soldier, shoots Lear, injuring him. Lear continues to shovel. The farmer's son shoots Lear again, killing him. Lear's body is left alone on the stage. Edward Bond has used some of the conventions of epic theatre in this play. Epic theatre is a theatre developed by Bertolt Brecht, the 20th century playwright. Epic theatre refers to a political theatre which, unlike conventional plays, develops a sequence of many scenes. And in Lear, we often find such a sequence of many scenes broken at every time. More than that, we find in the play Lear, characters often speaking to the audience. This sort of communication between the character and the audience breaks the play and creates the alienation effect. The spectators do not identify with the play. They get the opportunity to think about it and develop a critical perception of it. And we find that there are violent incidents happening in our society, and when they occur, he depicts them truthfully on stage. At the same time, Bond is not interested in depicting violence just for the sake of violence. Violence is never a solution, but at the same time, according to him, violence is a problem that has to be dealt with. We can say that in Bond's plays, violence is a defensive strategy to survive in an unjust, irrational system. Bond's play Lear is an allusion to Shakespeare's play King Lear. But we find that there is nothing similar apart from the name Lear. Bond's attempt is to deconstruct Shakespeare's classic tragedy, King Lear. And in Bond's play, Cordelia is portrayed not as Lear's youngest and compassionate daughter, but as a rural female Castro. She is a young female catapulted into radicalized political consciousness. She is a rebel, driven to action through her experience of being raped by the soldiers. So it is clear that there is no similarity between Bond's Lear and Shakespeare's King Lear. We can understand from this that Edwin Bond is a representative writer who tries to bring the theater back to the society. He was much against the tradition of absurdism, and also he was against the kitchen sink trend that was happening in the British theater. On the other hand, he was preoccupied with contradictions within the society, violence within the society, social unrest that was happening in his contemporary time, and the political confrontations that affect our society. So Bond can be considered as a committed writer who tried to respond to the socio-political tensions of his contemporary time. So far, we have discussed the play Lear and the various aspects of the play. including the story, its association with King Lear, and the topics like violence and theatrical techniques like epic theater, etc. I hope you have got a general idea about the play. You will be able to learn more about the play by referring the books mentioned in the further reading section. Thank you.